morning. Welcome to church. Let me stand over here. Good morning. Welcome to church. This morning we have one baptism, and we're very thankful for this young lady. About 2.5 weeks ago, she came to youth group, had been coming, and she said, I'm concerned about my future. I really would like to know more about the church. And as we talked that night, she discovered that she had never trusted Christ. So right out there while the kids, young people were playing nine square, we stepped aside and I shared with her what the Word of God said, the gospel, and then she prayed that night on Wednesday evening after youth group to receive Christ. And so she's coming today. We didn't really know her name at first, so we kind of nicknamed her Heidi, but her name's not Heidi. Her name is Shaylee Maloney, and she's a junior at Keystone. So Shaylee, why don't you come down? Shaylee, have you trusted Christ as your Savior? Because your faith in Christ as your Savior, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life.
So now as we go to our time of worship, I'm going to have Allie and Cody, come on down. They're going to read scripture and pray for us. Let's just direct our hearts to the Lord. We're excited to worship. A lot of our teens are helping involved in worshiping today as well. So Allie's going to go ahead and read scripture, and then Cody will come and pray.
My son, forget not my law. Let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
All right, let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to be in church this morning, Lord. I pray that you would bless this service, and we'll give all the glory to you, Lord. Help us as we worship, Lord, and help this to be an amazing service, and help us to absorb your word and understand what you're trying to speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold, he must hold me fast. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast. He saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast. For my life he bled and died, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, he will hold me fast. Reigns with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. And this song was from the young people last month, Ancient of Days. A great message. Sing it with us now. Though the nations rage, kingdoms rise and fall, there is still one King reigning over all. So I will not fear, for this truth remains, that my God is the Ancient of Days. None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hand. For His throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in His name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. Through the dread of night overwhelms my soul, He is here with me, I am not alone. Oh, His love is sure, and He knows my name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hands. For the throne it shall remain and never stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in His name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. On the last verse now. Though I may not see what the future brings, I will watch and wait for the Savior King. Then my joy complete, standing face to face in the presence of the Ancient of Days. None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hands. All the throne shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in His name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hand. For His throne it shall remain and ever stand. His name, for my God is the Ancient of Days. For my God is the Ancient of Days.
Well, before the teen choir sings, I want to take this opportunity, if there are any other teens that are out in the auditorium that haven't made it up to the choir loft yet, this is a great time to join us as I introduce this song. So the song that the teens will be singing for you this month is really special, and I think it really just ties in with what the pastor has been preaching on and what we've been studying in youth group. You know, the pastor has been preaching on worship, in the youth group, we've actually been going through a study on pride. What is pride? How does it show up in our daily lives? How can we go about it? And we've been learning, you know, pride is ultimately the source of so many sin problems that we have. You know, we get angry because we're proud, you know. And so as we're coming to the time of worship, the song that we're singing, it's titled Only a Holy God. And so the entire focus of this song is who we should be directing our worship to. You know, we come in on a Sunday morning, we're singing, you know, it's really easy to get distracted, you know, but the reality is we're coming here because we have a God that is holy, that is perfect, that we love, that has saved us. And so this song is just a great representation. So I want to encourage you, as you listen, these guys are going to do a great job, but more importantly than that, I want you to listen to the words, to hear what it's saying, and let's just direct our praise to the Lord. So guys, if you go ahead and stand, we're going to sing our song together, Only a Holy God.
Who else commands all the host of heaven? Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. The glory consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy could rescue me from my failing? Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only.
At this time, we're going to have a recognition, and I want Huntley to come on down, if you would. And Miss Penny has a presentation she wants to make to Huntley. And Miss Penny.
Not only do these young people serve in the worship service, there are some teenagers that also serve in Freedom Kids, our children's church ministry. So when I call your name, would you please come and stand somewhere on the platform for me? First of all, Huntley, come on up. Lorelei Hall, Lila Hall, Allie Stevens, Cody Mobley, Baron Bryson, Joseph Stevens, and Ben Ulch. These young people help the children to pay attention to the lesson, take attendance, count the offering, help the youngest ones to the restroom or to get a drink, help with boo-boos, help with craft time, help with game time, serve as puppeteers, work the audio-video equipment, serve food to the children, and clean up the children's room after the service and Puppet Sunday. They are invaluable. For myself, I literally could not teach your children as effectively if I did not have their help. There are two teenagers that will be graduating this May, Cody and Ben. I really hope they'll continue to serve if the Lord keeps them in Keystone, but as you know, teenagers grow up and move on. And that leaves a gap in Freedom Kids that is hard to fill. So I challenge the teenagers, if you know the Lord as your Savior, and you have a desire to serve the Lord and be faithful, speak to these teenagers and ask them about their service. We always need puppeteers. Then you can speak to Pastor Stevens, Pastor Weston, or me, and we would be glad to help you. But there is one teenager on stage today, we don't cry, that we would like to give special recognition to. For over 2 years, he has run the audio video equipment, helped with the children, helped with craft time and game time, served food, played his guitar for us so we could sing along, helped clean up the children's room and get it set up for Wednesday, watched the outside door for safety and for after church arrival of parents, and anything else I ask him to do. I am going to miss him greatly. So today, we honor Huntley Dennis for his service to the Lord and to our church. I will sorely miss him. Huntley, can you make your way over here? We'd like to give you a certificate of appreciation for your service in Children's Church. And here's a card for you. I can't say enough about him. I thank him all the time for his service with me because he does so many things. But my question now is, who's going to take his place? Would you please pray with me that the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers into his harvest? Thank you, teenagers, for your service. I really appreciate everything that you do. You're a blessing. Thank you.
Well, at this time, we're going to recognize two graduates, and we're very thankful for them. After we recognize them, they share a little bit about what they're doing. Then we'll have a time where we stand up, we shake hands, and the kids can be dismissed to Freedom Kids. So I'm going to let Pastor Weston come and share a word about them. But I'll just say about Cody and Ben, being here over 10 years, we've had the joy and privilege to see these boys grow up. And I always joke with Ben about the ugly one, which I don't see the ugly one in the choir. Oh, wait, there's Ian. No. Ben pointed right over there, but he has several brothers over there, but I think we both know who he's talking about. But we've seen these boys grow up. Sam graduated last year, and now Ben, and we're so thankful for him. Then we have Billy, who graduated, it seems like forever ago, Billy, doesn't it? How many years now? Yeah, 2 years. And now his little brother, and in some ways, little brother, Cody, is graduating. And it's been a joy to see these boys at camp, to see them here in youth group, to see them at their games, and then now to see what God is going to do with their lives as they graduate later this month. In just a moment, we're going to let them speak, and then we're going to present them with a Bible, and then we'll all stand in fellowship. I will ask the grads and Huntley that when we shake hands, I'd like for you guys, and Shaylee, by the way, to stand right here down front so people can come and shake your hands, hug your neck, and speak to you, because I know after service, as soon as we dismiss, everyone's gone. So I'll remind you guys at that time. Pastor Wilson.
It's kind of hard to even put into words what these two guys mean to us as a church family, and You know, this is coming from me, who's only been here with you guys coming up on a year now. We were just talking about that in the office this week. You know, we've only been here serving the youth for around a year, but both of these guys have been an incredible blessing. They're huge leaders. I tell them all the time, you know, all of the teens look up to them. They're great examples. We're just super thankful for what the Lord's done in their lives, and it's kind of crazy. It doesn't feel like it's been a full year, but you know, it has been, and now they're both seniors. They're going to be graduating soon. We're just super excited for them to see what the Lord's going to do. We just are praying for them, you know, to continue serving the Lord, and we're super excited to see what God's going to do in their lives. They're a huge blessing. So we're going to start off. Cody, you want to come on down? We'll start with you.
If I could like share anything about but throughout high school and everything, I've kind of realized through playing sports and everything, the biggest thing, like Pastor Weston said, was being a leader, being looked up to and always looked at by a little sister. She sometimes looks up to me, but being looked up to by everyone that's younger than you, it was kind of like a role that like I was like almost tossed into being a senior on a varsity football team. It was like, here you go, you're going to be a kid that is tossed into a leadership role, and all these little kids that you think are not watching you, they're not watching you now. And as I go to college, I plan on attending USF, going down south to Tampa, and getting a mechanical engineering degree. Hopefully that all plans out. It's all in God's will, and I know it's in his hands, and I know that he can help me move forward towards that, and if that's what he wants me to do and that's the calling, then that's what I'm going to go towards. But growing up, I want to thank my mom, my dad, just thank you, Billy, for being a big brother. I want to thank God for everything that he's given me. I'm so thankful for all that I have, but it's tough. It's different. And but my mom and dad have inspired me to keep being me, keep doing what I do. If some of y'all know me, you know I'm a little goofy, so I got a little goofy attitude that comes with me. But hopefully I can move forward, continue my education, and I'm just so thankful for everything that God has given me and that God continues to give me. And then that's it.
Well, thank you so much, Cody. We all love you so much. I'm so glad you're here this morning. I want to say thank you to just everybody, this whole church family. I've been here for 8 years, just over 8 years, and you guys have shown me so much love and support, and I won't forget anything that each and every one of you has done for me. I want to thank Pastor Jason and Pastor Weston. They've guided me to be as close to the Lord as I am right now, and I want to thank my family, all 5,000 of my little brothers and my big brother. I love you guys so much. I thank my grandparents. Both of you guys mean so much to me, and I'm so thankful for both of y'all. And most importantly, I want to thank God. He has been so incredibly good to me. Just over these 8 years I've been at this church and 4 years of high school, people say it goes by quick, but it's felt like a lifetime to me. But God has just had his hand in my life, and I'm so thankful for everything that he continues to do in and through me. This whole year has been, it's kind of been daunting, the fact that I'm going to be going on to things past high school. You know, 9th through 11th grade, it's been, oh, I got sports, I got time, I got school, I got all these things I'm worried about. I'm not worried about what's going to happen down the road. But this year hits, and you're like, oh goodness, this is a real thing that's happening. This is reality. I got to figure out what's going on. So, going into this year, I've always had pretty good grades, and praise the Lord for that. and I applied to a couple of different colleges, and I got in to all the colleges that I want to, except for the one that I really wanted to get into. So it kind of threw me for a loop. And through a lot of prayer and asking the Lord to just allow me to be patient, there was a point where I had it narrowed down to two schools. One was pretty far away, and one was, you know, 20 minutes down the road from where we're moving here in a couple months. And the deadline came for housing and different things, and I was just so stressed out. I had no idea what it is that I was going to do. I thought by that time God would have opened my eyes to where I needed to go, and it just hadn't been the case. And I was so stressed out and worried, and talking with my grandparents. Sometimes God doesn't give you a yes or no answer. He tells you just to wait. And in that time, it was like, well, I got to get this, and this done. There's deadlines for things. And God just really put it on my heart to just wait on him. So that deadline passed, and the next week came up, and I got to shadow a man that's building our house here in a couple months and get to see what he did through his job. And I knew I wanted my major when I go to college to be some type of construction management or architecture of building homes. And I really got to just see what he did. And he really just allowed me to be at peace about what God was doing. And I decided to go to college at Santa Fe College in Gainesville, which is very close to where we are moving. And God worked it out so much better than I could have ever imagined. He has allowed it to be close to home. He has allowed it to be a lot more affordable, and God has just put me at great peace about this whole situation. So I'm so thankful for each and every one of you guys and just how God's been working in my life. And if there was one thing I could tell you guys, my favorite verse is Philippians 4:7, and it talks about the peace of God surpasses all understanding, and it will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So if you're ever stressed out, which we all get stressed out, just pray that God would bring a peace in your life to guard your hearts and your minds, because in his time, he will give it to you, and it truly is so amazing. So thank you guys so much, and God bless.
Shaylee, would you mind? Can we give you your Bible as well? You mind coming on down? And then let me have Ben and Cody come stand down front, and then we'll have Shaylee do the same. We'll have these boys. And Shaylee, you can come on up here, and I'll give you your Bible. And so Shaylee, this is who was just baptized, and she started coming to church with the ugly brother. I'm just kidding. It's one of the brothers. And she's been coming, having questions, as was mentioned. And I asked her last week, I said, do you want to say anything? I said, this is your testimony. She says, I don't know, but I feel like I want to. But I'll tell you, that night when she had those questions and accepted the Lord, just a wonderful night. Everything going on around, and she was just so focused in on what the Lord was dealing with her heart about. And as we talked and we prayed, she says, I want to ask the Lord to receive me. I want him to come into my life. And so I'm so proud of her. We've told her we're so thankful for her, and her mom's here with her today. I think she's got some other family. And so we have this Bible for her just to let you know we love you and we're praying for you. So what we're going to do, we're going to have everyone stand. The youth choir will go down. The kids will go next door. And y'all come forward and shake hands while the music plays. I'm going to ask Pastor Weston to come over. Daniel chapter 1 this morning. Daniel chapter 1. And about a month ago, we began this somewhat informal conversation that we've been talking about, and we'll go ahead and get our slide up there. So these sheets that you're receiving, we gave these out a month ago. Some of you turned these in already, and so we are going to turn them out one more time. So if you can, let's get the lights on. Thank you so much. So if you would just fill these out somewhat during the service, but drop them in the offering plate at the close, so when the offering plate is passed at the end of service. These are things that we're talking about today. We talked about a month ago. We talked about Solomon. We dealt with a concerned parent who is leading his family and helping his kids make choices. And today we're going to talk about a young adult
who's away from home. And we're talking about Daniel 1. So let's make sure everybody has that. And then if you'll turn to the Old Testament, and that is Daniel chapter 1. And we'll give everyone a chance to turn there. And so on your sheet, it just says on the back, what conversations are important to you? What conversations are necessary for your family? What are you currently concerned about, and how can we pray for you? And these are conversations that we began a month ago talking about sitting down at the family table and having important conversations. So today is a little bit different and actually somewhat interesting because we have two young men who are about to leave the nest, as it were. They're becoming young adults, and they're going off to college. And so Daniel, in like fashion, was a young man who did the same. So Daniel chapter 1, and why don't we split up our reading, Pastor Wesson? I'm going to read verses 1 through 9 here, and then I'll let you read further. So Daniel chapter 1, it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well-favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. So again, these are young men, more than four. They have been kidnapped from Israel, taken hostage in a war, and they are now coming into Babylon, and for 3 years of basic training, they have to learn a new language, learn a new education, learn new food, and then stand before the king at the end of 3 years. Now, among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. I want you to read a little further, Pastor Weston.
And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who hath appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which are of the sword? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Then said Daniel to Melzar, whom the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat. And as thou seest, deal with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzar took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink and gave them pulse. As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the king had said he should bring them in, then the prince of the eunuchs before them, before Nebuchadnezzar, and the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. And Daniel continued even unto the first year of King Cyrus.
So let's pray, and then we're going to jump right in. Dear Lord, thank you that we can sit down today and talk as a dad, as a young man who, fresh from college, that has been close to the young people and in their age, Lord, being able to see where they are and what they've gone through. Lord, I pray that as grandparents who are here, great-grandparents, aunts, uncles, friends, cousins, neighbors, Lord, that we all would look at this young man, Daniel, and the choices he made. Lord, we know the world is trying to conform us to their image. And Lord, sometimes we are on that fine line of should I fit in? Should I blend in? What should I do? So as young people, Lord, I pray that they would have the wisdom that they discern from their parents, that they get from the Word of God, that they are able to stand on their own two feet when they leave the house. But Lord, that also you would give parents the wisdom and the wherewithal to speak to their young people, to tell them the truth. Because, Lord, we can't make the decisions for them. We can't choose for them what they need to do. And, Lord, when they stand alone, I pray that you would help them to have the courage to do it with boldness and to do it even if no one else does. And we ask all these things, Lord, in your name. Amen. Now, on your bulletin, if you have a bulletin, if you don't have a bulletin, you can feel free. They're on the Welcome Center table. On the back of the bulletin, you have the notes of the conversation that we had a month ago, and we were only able to tackle Solomon. And we talked about a concerned parent, someone who was involved and active in their kid's life. And Solomon was not the quintessential dad. Solomon was a womanizer. Solomon was an alcoholic at one point in his life. Solomon was a pretty wealthy person that said, if I saw it, I got it. So we're taking advice from a man, the Bible says, who was very wise, but went a little wayward, and he came back to the Lord. And as he's looking back, he's telling his kids, don't do that. I know, don't do that. And a month ago, we talked about that, and we've listed that on your sheet, an invested parent actively involved in instructing his kids. So as we looked at that, we saw the parents' end of it. And now today, we want to look at Daniel and how Daniel really was a young adult away from home who is committed and courageous. So Pastor Weston, you left home initially to go to East Tennessee State. So what went into that decision as you left home from high school, and how did your parents, your pastor, your church, your mentors factor into that decision when you left home?
Yeah, that's really interesting. So actually, when I went to East Tennessee State, I was still living at home because it was in my hometown. But my real leaving home was going into my sophomore year of college when the Lord laid on my heart to pursue ministry. I thought I was going to be a veterinarian. I had done all of the work. I had all the volunteer hours, all the work hours. I was going for pre-med, pre-vet at a big state school, which is what you're supposed to do. That's what they told me. And the Lord just redirected me, and I think I've shared that before. So that was really, really the decision, and that was a really hard thing, because a lot of people thought, when I said I'm staying home, I'm going to the school in my hometown, all of this stuff, a lot of people thought, okay, he's going to be around here for at least the next 4 years. The people at church, everything, they thought I was going to be there. And so then when it totally changed, and it's like, now I'm going into ministry, but that also means I'm going to be living 3 hours away. I'm not going to be here at church every day. I'm not going to be living at home anymore. That brought about a lot of change. And so, there were some people asking me if I could drive 3 hours home, for every church service. And it's like, I don't think I'm going to be able to do that, So just a lot of stuff like that. And so, yeah, there was a lot going into it, but a lot of prayer and just trusting the Lord to direct me and just following the Lord's call, even though it may have disappointed some people, but I'm thankful that the Lord used it anyway.
So for me, I was the first kid to leave from my family. I have an older sister and a younger brother. And so when I left, I went 7.5+ hours away. And when my parents dropped me off, it was difficult. I can empathize with both what Cody and Ben were saying. When your family drops you off, you're strong, you're stout, you're like, this is going to be good. And then they leave you, and you're a little happy, but you're still a little nervous. And I mean, there were some tears. And I've heard from my dad, even when we were in Tennessee recently, he said, I told your mom, if she didn't stop crying, I'm going to turn this car around, we're going to go back. And she said, no, just leave him, it's going to be okay, my baby. And it was tough to leave home. But leaving home or growing up or making decisions that mom and dad can't always be there with you to make really helps young adults, young people, to find out who they are. And I think we've all been there where maybe we have been outside of the home. Maybe we still lived at home, but we were making decisions, and some of the decisions we made were boneheaded. And really what we're trying to get at this morning is that it is possible. In fact, it's highly possible that young people can truly stand on their own two feet, make wise decisions in a culture that is changing, in a culture that the pressure is so great. They can make an internal decision that results in an external change, even though people around them say, I don't like that, I don't think that's right, and the pressure is so great. This is exactly what happened to Daniel. Culture hasn't changed. If anything, culture's getting worse. They're trying to tell not just parents, as we looked a month ago, tell our young people what they should do. What we learn in Daniel 1, this is the introduction to Daniel and his friends. We don't know his parents' name. We don't know his uncles. We don't know any siblings. We don't know anything about his grandparents. All we know is that he had a good education. He was pretty smart. He was someone that was somewhat good-looking. He's a good-looking kid. He had friends. They all just collected all of these boys and young ladies, and they took them away to rob Israel of their future. And they said, we will re-educate you. We will indoctrinate you. You will learn what we say, and you will look to us as gods. And in fact, their names that were changed, all the names were changed to a Babylonian deity. So when you look at Daniel and his friends, all their names reflected the name of the one true God, as the youth choir sang. So look at your sheet and look at the introduction, and we want to read this, and then we're going to jump right into Daniel. This is what we said a month ago, and it hasn't changed. Culture has impacted how parents raise their kids, influence young people's behavior, and change the role of the home. So as believers, as followers of Jesus, we must recognize this and anchor our decisions in biblical truth. This series strengthens families by encouraging open conversations, critical thinking, and challenging cultural norms. So by intentionally discussing these issues here and at home, we can make wise decisions, establish a solid foundation, and lead by example. I think for all of us, some of us are blessed to have parents or maybe one parent that has really influenced us heavily. Some of you, maybe you didn't have the opportunity to be influenced by a godly mother or father, or maybe no mother or father. Maybe it was someone else, an uncle, an aunt, a coach, a teacher, someone that you highly respect. We know nothing about Daniel's family. All we know is about Daniel's decisions. And when Daniel went to a Babylonian pagan culture, what was taught to Daniel came out in his decisions. These boys are going to go away, Cody and Ben, and since they are the two graduates, you can imagine if it is like a Daniel, Hananiah, an Azariah, and Mishael, these men, these young men, they were 14 to 19 years old. They were taken out of their home, never to see it again, in captivity for 70 years. And these boys, these young men, teenagers, young adults, said, I am not going to do that. Under the threat of death, under the threat of some punishment that was severe, under the threat of who knows what, being away from home, their mamas and their daddies taught them well. So as we jump in here today, I want you as a parent, as a grandparent, to think about your kids, your grandkids. Think about the influence you have. Because when you left home, your mom and dad might have lived down the road, but they can't make the choices for you. These boys left home. We're going to say they left home to go away to college. And the choices they made impacted, if you read the rest of the book of Daniel, it impacted the rest of their lives. And in fact, it impacted an entire nation. So when we go away, we want to know that our choices matter, the people that surround us make a difference, and our future is secure because of what we believe and what we're standing on. So let's look at point number one, and we're going to go back and forth, Pastor Wes and I. We have been so excited about today, but it's been such a crazy week getting things ready. May is already a crazy month. And so coming from this different angle, I'm a parent, and my daughter's a senior now at Bob Jones University. Our son, Jordan, is 24. He graduated 2 years from college, and he's in Nashville. And Pastor Wes and Bethany graduated a year ago. Just from being in college for 6 years. So we're coming at it somewhat the same, but also somewhat different. And yet the one anchor is not my opinion. Well, I'm older than you, so you need to listen to what I say. Or I'm younger than you. I'm more culturally relevant. I'm with it, yo, or whatever it is. You're can I say the word sus? I don't know where you say it to me. I know that's all the lingo. So I'm old, he's young. However, the anchor of my decisions is not what my mom and my dad said. It's not even what a church has said. Because churches can drift from the Word of God. Parents can drift from the Word of God. We can drift along with culture to get to the point where my grandfather, who was born at the turn of the last century, 1915, the culture is so different from 1915 to 2024. So do we drift along with culture? In some regards, yes. But in some regards, absolutely not. So not a young and old, a father and a son, but what does the Bible say? What does God say is important to young people as they're leaving home and as they're there? So Pastor Weston, why don't we jump into these points and you tackle point number one and I'll follow up with you.
Is my copy of the notes over there? Is there a copy of the notes? I will give you. I was sitting there last time, so I think I might have.
Okay, I'll give
there
you.
There we go. Thank you. Yeah, so point number one with Daniel. So kids need real, loving, consistent role models, not picture-perfect parents. And this is just a huge thing. It's really interesting. Even just coming into a position of leadership, leading the teens, you know, as soon as we, Bethany and I, came into the leadership role, you know, youth pastor's wife, leading the teens, the instant temptation is, well, we got to be perfect, right? You know, we can't mess up, we can't whatever. You know, if anyone sees us mess up, then we won't have respect, we won't be able to lead, we won't be able to guide, whatever. And, you know, we aren't parents yet, but Pastor Jason will be able to speak to that. I imagine that it's exactly the same way as a parent, as a grandparent. I know it is in any position of leadership. There is always, you know, the desire to be perfect, you know. But the reality is, when we're looking up to someone, it's actually so much more helpful to be able to see their imperfections and to see the way that they address those, to see the way that they grow, and, you know, to admit, you know what, I messed up, or I didn't treat you right there, whatever that is. It, you know, you can tell with Daniel in the way that he responded, he isn't just, you know, I'm not just doing what I was told just because I was told it and I've just been a good little soldier. He actually took ownership himself. You know, he was completely separated from his parents, from his family, from his entire culture. And he was being encouraged and forced in a lot of ways to conform, and with no peer pressure to do the right thing, with peer pressure to do the wrong thing, he still stuck to how he'd been taught. So we can gather from this passage that he had role models that he saw, and he said, you know what, I need what they have. I'm going to do what they are doing. I'm going to look up to them and follow their example, not because I have to, but because I want to.
I agree. I was 18 when I left home, and I remember sitting, and I've shared this before, sitting on the edge of the bed. My parents were talking about leaving. It was getting close, and there was some tension, and I just said, when I have kids, you know, and what 18-year-old really is thinking about kids, when I have kids, I think it's because they didn't want me to go out and do something, but I have kids, I'm not going to be as strict with them, or I'm going to be different. And you know, my mom started crying, and moms do that. And my dad, she sat down on the edge of bed next to me, and my dad kind of put his head down, and he said, well, son, then I guess you've learned something. He said, because when you're a parent, you're gonna find out. And, you know, I always look back on that when I talk to my kids, because my mom and dad, definitely they're not perfect. And they have emphasized that through their actions and how they have come to us and talked to us about things. And not every parent's that way. His daddy wasn't like that. My grandfather didn't tell my dad the words like "I love you" till he was like in his 40s or 50s, and from that generation. And so my dad, that verbalization of that empathy or that relationship. So when decisions are made, parents are needed to be picture perfect, just real, loving, and consistent. talking to kids. That's why we sat at the table. I mean, it's just kind of a picture, but whatever it is for you and your kid, you and your young adult, if you don't have the conversation with them, you can be guaranteed what's being fed into their minds, into their lives, into their music, into their media, into their education, into their relationships, into their party scene, whatever, that is being fed. The message is loud and clear. And as parents, you can't be with them 24/7. So having this image of perfection, no, we should verbalize to them, this is where I really messed up. These are the mistakes that I made when I was your age. This is how I got through it. And this is how you'll make it through as well. And so Daniel, we can see reflected in this. It's interesting. They changed their name. They changed their language. They changed their clothes. And then they try to change their food. And I wrote a couple things down. I just want to say, Daniel didn't object to the name that was given to him. We don't see anything he didn't say in this. In fact, he requested of the king, can we not eat this, please? I don't know about you. There are certain things that I don't fancy. I don't really like them as much as other things. Other day, Claire and I went out on a date. It's a new place, and we didn't really know much about it, but it had five stars on Yelp, which I don't know if that's good or not. But it's in Middleburg, and it's in the public shopping center plaza. So I don't know. Does anybody? So I kind of knocked on wood before we went. I said, okay, I'm going to trust you. We went there, and it was this sushi place that was kind of fusion. And we went in not knowing really what to expect, not knowing really what we're going to do. And I was impressed. And now younger me, I'd be like, no way. But the food they brought out was so much that we couldn't even eat it all. It was amazing. But the taste changed as you get older or when you're younger. Daniel didn't object to his name being changed because he was confident in who he was. He didn't object to the education because he knew what he believed. But he did object to the food because when you read the story, it violated God's word. There were certain things that were offered to them to eat or to drink. And he said, this would violate what God has told us not to do. You can try to change my name or call me names all you want. I know who I am. You can try to re-educate me, but I know what I believe. But this one thing is too far for me. So it's really, as parents, establishing that identity with our kids by telling them, we know who we are. And although we've made mistakes, and you will too, God can settle that foundation. He can give you something to stand on. Look at number two. Kids need guidance at home, rooted in faith, to succeed as they leave home. Now, how many of you left home at one point or another? You left home and you moved at least out of the house. Not talking about getting married, but you went to college, you went to the military, you took a job, a career. How many of you left home at least for a little bit? Would you raise your hand? Who left home? See, majority. How many of you kind of just stayed home? You stayed close to family. You stayed somewhat on the property or just down the road. How many of you stayed close to home? Okay, some of you. I think all of us, at some point or another in our life, we leave home to a degree, but our faith has to be rooted. It has to be grounded deep. And not just in what the traditional church that we grew up in says, or what our mom and dad has taught us. It has to be rooted, as we're talking, Daniel, in the scripture, rooted in what God has said, rooted in what's eternal. Because once we face challenges as Daniel and his friends face, they're trying to uproot everything to get them to discount, to disbelieve, to walk away from. And I really wonder, as reading this, what did Daniel's parents think? What did his family think? What was going through their minds as they were away from home? It must have been challenging for them. But here are these young men, only four. There were thousands that were taken. We only know four names of the thousands taken. And four young men determined, we're rooted. Let's stand. Let's go deep. Let's not be shallow in our faith. So many people are shallow, their surface level in their faith. You know, we come at this time, we get in to get out, we sing the song, we throw something in the plate, and this is about where our faith is. But if our kids are going to succeed, we have to teach them to go deeper in the Word. And that has to be deeper than just on Sundays. It's got to walk out of here with them when they go. Pastor Wesson, any thoughts of that point?
Yeah, one thing that sticks out to me with this, I've heard this in regards to evangelism, you know, sharing the gospel with others. You know, a lot of times we can have the attitude of, you know, I'm going to live my life in a way that others will be brought to the Lord. And yes, we can draw others to the Lord by our actions. But ultimately, for someone to be led to the Lord, we have to use our words. You know, we can live in a way that someone says, you know, I want what you have, but we still have to say words. You know, you can't just walk away from that and hope they get saved on their own. You have to say, okay, this is why I am who I am. This is why I believe what I believe, and this is what you need to do. And so in the same way, you know, bringing kids to church, having kids in church, even living your life as a Christian is great, and that's what needs to happen as parents. But there is so much value in having the conversations, actually talking through, this is what we're doing, this is why, this is what's important, this is how I've lived, this is how I want you to learn, even as we said, not making the same mistakes, that sort of thing, super valuable in actually taking the time to have these conversations.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing for me as a parent, my son is going to be 24 next month. Taylor just turned 21 last month. And we have a 16-year-old wanting to learn to drive and a 12-year-old. And, you know, the principle in Proverbs says, train up a child in the way they should go. And when they're old, what does it say? They won't depart from it. And, you know, it's tough because so many people they've raised their kids in church. They brought them to Sunday school. They put them in youth group. They put them in the youth choir. They let them participate in youth activities. They went to summer camp. They, whatever it might be, they were well involved, and then their kids walk away. They left home. They got involved with someone or something. They got deep into something that they were disappointed in, and their kids just walked away. And some of you may be still at this point. Your kids are not back where they used to be. And so in Proverbs, we look at what Solomon is saying. Think of David, who taught his son. And Solomon, David had some flaws, but Solomon was a serial womanizer, a drunkard at one point, and really he was somewhat suicidal. I hate my life. It's a principle. It's not a promise. But really, we can cling to the promise of God that when we do the right thing before God and we're open with our kids and we talk to them about things, it won't always be a straight line, nor will that line be like the line we walked. I don't expect my kids to walk in the same path that I did. And I'm glad my father didn't for me. It was definitely jagged, but looking back now as a dad at my dad and seeing the choices he made at the ages in which he made them, I can now, as an older guy, look back and say, teenage me was kind of really impatient with my parents. I didn't understand. I didn't have the answers. And when I left home, I didn't truly appreciate all the sacrifices that they had made. And Daniel and his friends had to grow up fast. In the world we live in, they're educating children that are 5 and 6 years old with things that they used to educate 16, 17, 18-year-old kids. They know more at a younger age than you did at that older age. So culture is changing so rapidly that if we don't have the conversation about the things that truly matter in their life, and not just their boyfriend or girlfriend or education, but about the things of God, the eternal truths that will not change, when the hard things come up, and they will. That's interesting. When she came, we were talking, and she said, you know, was it a year ago, the TikTok video? Is that what it was? It was a while back. She said, I saw this TikTok video of someone sharing the gospel or talking about salvation, and I was like, I need to know. And it really began her mind thinking, and she kept talking about this TikTok video that she saw with someone sharing the gospel. And I thought, you know, in the culture in which we live, somebody might not park it in a pew on a Sunday morning. They might not in the culture. People are running. But if the gospel is shared, the seed is planted. When the seed is planted, that's what we're saying. Being rooted in faith It might be a video that plants it. It might be a pastor, a youth pastor, a parent, a coach, a teacher, a Sunday school teacher. But when that seed is planted and then it is watered and God begins to work on that person, He will bring them to Himself. And that's where parents, we have a role in that. And we can't discount our role. We need to sit down and share with our young people. Let's look at number three quickly. Kids who know God will understand who they are and why they're here. I think this goes without saying from Daniel. They were pretty confident in who they were. They requested, read the verbs here in chapter 1, they requested of the king's eunuch, can we do this? Put us to the test. We just want our vegetables and our water. Put us to the test this many days and we'll be stronger and fitter and faster than the rest of them. Please. They didn't demand it. They didn't sit in a protest with their arms folded. We're not going to do this because we're more spiritual. We have a God and you... No, they requested and they came at this approach. They knew who they were. They knew why they were there. They said, God still has a purpose for us even though we're outside of our home. So parents, we have the opportunity to pour into our kids to help them establish who God is to them. But in so doing, they can understand through God and through His Word why I exist today. It's really sad when so many young people and even old people, they question their existence for life. They're taking their lives. They're doubting the value of their own lives. I'm worth nothing. Life is meaningless. And these boys here, certainly, no parents, no family, no future. Their country is behind. It was left in ruins. Read the prophets. The entire landscape was just a trash heap, smoke in the air. As they carried them away. No doubt these boys with tears in their eyes. And yet they still believed they could make a difference. Someone asked me yesterday, do you watch the news a lot? Or where do you get your news? And I'm like, honestly, I don't. I mean, I get news. I don't have time for that. I mean, I know what's going on. But I'll tell you what, if we just focus on what's going on in this country and the world around us, which we need to know, it's a mess. It's chaotic. The election's coming up, but boy, it's a mess. But this world that our kids are going to grow up into, I can't send them back. Some people say, well, I wouldn't have kids in this world. Really? I mean, they're coming whether you like it or not. The question is, what kind of world are we going to leave for them as we anchor them to truth? It is getting worse, but we can have better kids that know who God is and know what God wants of them. Pastor Weston, what do you think about that point number three?
Yeah, even just looking at the way that our kids interact with culture, we were even talking about this past Wednesday night. You know, if we look at Scripture and then compare it to what the culture has to say, there's so much differing opinions. We talked about what is our purpose. You know, if we read in Scripture, we see that our purpose in being here on this earth is to glorify God. That's our purpose. And then if we look at, you know, what is our value? Well, our value is we're created in the image of God and we're able to bring glory to God. And so when we look at the culture that says your worth is dependent on what you do, your appearance, your accomplishments, your connections, all of this, you know, if we are not actively speaking truth and telling kids, teens, young adults, no, that's not true. That's not what your value is. Your value isn't just in your, you know, your popularity, your status, your achievements, whatever. Then they only have that to believe. So it's important that we speak the truth, that they're rooted and grounded in what the Bible actually says. And we see that Daniel and his friends were, because even when that positive influence was removed, they still stuck to what they knew was correct. And that's, there could be no greater desire for any parent or parental figure than for when they are no longer able to speak truth, those that they have taught are still holding true to what they've been taught.
Yeah, the peer pressure. I think when we outlined this back in March, one of the biggest things was peer pressure. And there's peer pressure not just for young people, but for old people, for us. There's pressure on the job to perform, to conform. There's pressure if you're a teacher, there's pressure, no matter what you're doing, your business, there's pressure with other parents on the soccer field, whatever there might be, to measure up based on the social media standard what is out there. But your value is not found in how you appear, how people judge you. It really, God looks, the Bible says, at the heart. He sees you for who you really are. And if you're a believer, you are valuable. If you're just someone that doesn't even know God, you're created in His image, and you are more valuable than you even realize. And God has a great plan for your life. And the devil, or this world system, culture will tell you, listen, this is what you got to do to fit in. This is how you can be accepted. This is how people will like you more. This is what you need, what you should drive, how much money you should have, what you should look like, who you should cheer for, what you should listen to. And if you go against any of those things, then it's like this wall that Daniel and his friends, and they just simply said, in fact, verse number 10, I believe it is, he says, Daniel purposed in his heart. He says, I've made a decision here. Here. And from that decision that he made, it impacted the rest of the choices that he made going forward. To where when you read the story of Daniel in the lion's den, you don't really think about this, but do you know Daniel was 80 years old? He was 80. He's about 15 to 19 in chapter 1. He's 80 when they throw him in with a bunch of lions. We like to think of this young, strapping, young adult kind of Maximus gladiator figure. He's in there with the lions. No, he's an old man thrown in there, and we're going to let this old man die. He made choices when he was young. He was still doing that when he was old. And why was he thrown in there when he was old? They said it's against the law to pray. It's against the law to come out and publicly pray. And if we find you praying and breaking the law, you're going to be thrown in. You know what he did? Like he did every other day, he opened up his windows, he put his face toward Jerusalem, and he began to pray, and they arrested him, they threw him in. So it's not just someone who is very old that has strength and courage and boldness. It's young people. And if you don't have that as a young person, you can. And boldness comes from the Lord. Boldness is not just being able to score a touchdown or a basket or get good grades or impress your friends or have a fast car, whatever it is, or earn a lot of money. Boldness and being courageous is standing up when no one else will. When other people are going in one way and you say, this is what is right, even if it's your own family, standing there and saying no. And that is very hard because I think all of us, when we're alone, we've all wilted in the moment. But Daniel and his friends, on the written page of Daniel, there is nothing in the Bible written about him that was flawed. We know he was a human being, but he was a wise young man that listened. Number four, quickly. Kids who know God's word are more likely to stand strong in tough situations. I think we've hit that. Think of the toughest situation you face when you're a young person. Maybe for you, it was you were offered, I don't know, some drugs, or you were offered, I don't know, there was some immoral activity. Maybe there was something that you were alone that you had the opportunity to do. Maybe it's in a group of friends. I don't know, the pressure was greater. You were confronted with something that you could do that no one would know, and you could get away with it. Well, what we see here, kids who know what God thinks about it, they know what God says about it, they're more likely to stand strong when the storm comes. Pastor Watson, what do you think of point number four?
Yeah, I think this just goes off of what we've already said. I mean, think about this. If Daniel's parents would have just said, you know, they'll see the way that we live and they'll just pick it up, they'll just figure it out on their own. You know, if they had not told them specifically what was important and why they did what they did, you know, when Daniel and his friends were alone with all these influences, they would have had no reason to not just go with the flow and follow along with the culture. And, you know, think about this. Daniel's parents had no idea that this was going to happen. They had no idea at what point their children were just going to be taken away from them. But we know that they had been intentional all the way through, no doubt from when the time they were babies, young children. They had been training them, and their training wasn't complete. I'm sure their parents had a lot more they wanted to say, and I'm sure they grieved over the conversations they weren't able to have. But they instilled God's word in them enough that even when they were taken away from their positive influences at a very young age, they knew what was important.
And then the final point, kids who fear God will wisely wait, plan for the future, and be influential. You say, and I mention kids. I say that often about young people, but don't mean that as a slander. Young people who fear God will wait. You know, the world says you don't have to wait for anything. Give it to me now. I want it now. You know, when Claire and I first got married, I was 23. She was 22. Just had turned 22. When we first got married, you know, we didn't have furniture. We didn't have a lot. I mean, we lived off of love, as they say. We didn't have a lot. My best friend's dad gave us, like, his office study furniture, a pleather couch and a pleather seat. If it's hot, you peel yourself off of that and you can hear it. My dad gave us a Leave It to Beaver TV. It was this wooden box with a small little screen on wheels. It was horrible, but it was a TV. And then we went to the rescue mission down in Winston-Salem. I remember there was a washer and a dryer, a Maytag. Those things were so old, but they worked even the day we left the place. And then my aunt found us a place, and it was a little trailer, shag carpet about that deep. You lose your keys, they're gone forever. I mean, the 70s called, and they want their car back. And nothing matched. You had wood paneling, red shag carpet, pleather, whatever. I mean, it was just like... And today, and it was like that when I was growing up, everyone wants what their parents or grandparents have. You get out, I want it now. I need it now. So waiting becomes, they don't understand people work for those things, but Christian kids especially, what we're saying is kids who fear God and know God and trust God will wait. And not just for material things, the couch, the washer, the dryer, the car, sex, a relationship that will matter, a relationship that will last, friendships, career path. And I know what, for me as a parent, Claire and I, we talk about this, our kids, our two oldest, don't live anywhere around here. And it's tough. I mean, we're in touch with our kids every day. And some of you understand that. Your kids live apart from here. And it's tough as a parent because I want my kids close, but I want what God wants for my kids more than what I want for my kids. And I want them to be in the center of God's will. And sometimes that requires not just for my kids to wait, but for me as a parent to say, God, what do you want? And this is tough. When my son graduated from high school and Taylor, I was bawling. David and Janelle, I know you've gone through this already, but here it comes again, and it doesn't get easier. Rusty and Myra, when Ben's walking across, Sam, I want to see the ugly one as well, Andrew, the rest of you, John, I want to see you, the bawling, the tears. But kids who fear God and parents who fear God are willing to wait on what God wants. And sometimes it's that line of how do I know what God's will is in wisely waiting, wisely planning, and then thus being influential. Pastor Weston, as we close, what are thoughts you have with that?
The one thing that stood out to me in this specific point is something that we've tried to impress upon the teenagers, even as we're studying through, you know, about almost a year ago, we started a study in Sunday school on how to find God's will. And that's a super important thing, especially for teenagers going into being young adults. And one of the points that we came across in that study, how do we find God's will, is the fact that not every open door is from the Lord. An open door is an opportunity, and God uses open doors, God uses opportunities, but not every opportunity is God's will for you to walk through. You know, and we think about it practically, of course that's true. We have opportunities to mess up, to do bad things every day, and if we follow the Lord, we won't. But whether this is thinking about, you know, about future plans, whether this is just daily decisions, you know, there will be tons of open doors, tons of opportunities in front of us, in front of teens, in front of young adults, and it's only by knowing God's word and choosing to live in according to what it says, that we will know, okay, this is an opportunity that I need to pass by. I need to wait on what is of the Lord. I was even encouraged by what Ben had shared, just, you know, the willingness to wait and see what the Lord has. And so that was the main thing that stuck out to me.
So at the end of chapter 1, it says, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So these young men, apart from influence of the home, there was no one like them. And as parents, we think that about our own children. They're the best. There's no one like them. And that's fine. We can. But when God puts his stamp on it, says, these kids are special, that shows that someone was intentional. So look at the first 5 points, and I want to read them. It says, parents, before we close. Parents, just to remind you, parents have permission to ask tough questions and have hard conversations. Parents have authority and insight, but should be open and approachable. Parents should have a good memory, but not live in the past. Parents should hold their kids close, but also give them the freedom to grow up and to go. And parents who follow God will find it easier to guide their kids to follow his path. So my summation here is Daniel and his friends show us that inner conviction can overcome any outward pressure, and that God-honoring convictions will yield God-given rewards. If we allow the Lord through his word to guide our decisions, even though everyone around us, culture says, that's kind of weird. Why would you do that? Our faith, our decisions are tied into this, into truth. To Daniel, is even down to what he ate. He says, I'm not going to eat that. I can't drink that because God's word says. So for us, with our relationships, our decisions, our schooling, our parenting, whatever it might be, we can always go back to the word of God. And as we close, can I just say, as parents, we want to let you know, as grandparents, young people, kids, we're praying for you. And there are so many voices in the world saying so many things. And you and I, we have to get along with God and open his word and just say, God, what do you want me to do? What should I do today? Not what does the pastor want, not what does so-and-so want, not what does God, what do you want me to do today? Help me to open this and follow this. And the number one thing when you open this up that it will tell you, if you don't know the Lord, he will tell you this, I love you. If you don't know God, he'll tell you, and if you do know the Lord, he still says that same message, but I love you, and here's how. And in this book, when you open it, it says that God sent his son, Jesus, to die for you. He sent his son to die for you. You say, I don't even know him. No, God knows who you are. You are a created being. God made you in his image, and he created you for a purpose. God sent his son, Jesus, who lived a sinless life, to die for your sins, your faults, your wrongs, the things that I've done, the things that you've done. He died in my place. He died in your place. So what do I need to do? When I open this book, it tells me I can call on Jesus to ask him to forgive me of my sin. And some of you this morning, you're here today and you've gone to church or you've participated in some religious experience, but you've never made an internal decision where you have called on Jesus based on what he has done for you. Young people, you can't go to heaven based on who your mom and daddy are. And old people, you can't go to heaven based on getting dunked in a tank or giving money to a church. You and I go to heaven based on what Jesus Christ has done for us. And what did he do for us? He died for us. I see that sacrifice. I know that he died, he was buried, and he rose again. And he said, I'm coming again. And you can be my son or my daughter. You can be a part of the family. I have a seat for you at the table. And all you have to do is put your faith in him. I trust you, Lord, with my life. I trust you with everything that's going on. I trust you with everything that's going on in the future, what's happened to me in the past and right now in the present, Lord. I can't control anything, but I trust you. My faith is in you, and I call out to you. So the question is, when you open this book, have you made that decision? Have you called out to Jesus and asked him to save you? If you haven't done that, now's the opportunity for you to do so. You can do that right where you're seated. And in just a moment, we're going to have a verse of an invitation. And if, like Shaylee just a couple of weeks ago, she had questions, and she just said, you know, I don't know. I want to know. And all I did was open the Bible and said, this is what the Bible says. This is what God said. And God loves you right where you are, like you are. And he wants you to be part of the family. But you have to trust him. I can't do it for you. And if you're a Christian and you've kind of drifted with culture, you're a parent, you're a kid, you're a young adult, why not just make the decision? Public, yeah, fine. But what you do in public, it's really who you are in private. Choose in your heart what God wants for you. And then go out of here and live like it matters, because it does. People are watching you. Most importantly, the Lord. So if you're a Christian and you have drifted along with this culture, put your foot down, get out of that boat of culture, and get back where you need to be and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I repent, and I am returning to what you've called me to do. Help me to be like Daniel. Help me to purpose in my heart. I want to ask you those two questions, and I want you to be willing to commit yourself to that. Let's pray. So this morning, we have Tim and his wife, Abby, and we're so thankful. They've been coming for a little while. I mean, Abby was coming probably about a year ago, I guess it was, and they live up in Middleburg, but have kind of, you still are in Middleburg,
yep.
Still in Middleburg, got a house. So he's from Wisconsin, so if you talk to him, you can hear that a little bit, but Abby grew up in Middleburg. We're so thankful that they're here. They've given a testimony that they've been saved, they've been baptized, and they're coming to join with our church. And I just want to see how many of you want to welcome them into our church this morning by saying amen or lifted hand. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to have them after church to stand down front, and we're going to welcome them in. This is Tim and Abby. And after the offering and the closing song, you can come and shake their hands. Why don't you guys sit right here? Let's have our ushers come forward if you would. And if you're ready to give this morning and God has been good to you, I want to invite our musicians as well during the offering. You guys can come up. If you're ready to give, you can see ways to give. You can give through a tithing envelope. You can give online. You can scan the QR code that's in the bulletin. Just make sure that you give as unto the Lord. You give because you get to, not because you have to. But you pray, please, about what God would have you to give this morning. All of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Wake up the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame.
Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. We wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.